Good afternoon and welcome to the special celebration, the unveiling of our steam engine locomotive as well as the caboose. What I'd like to do is just talk a little bit about history, the history of Allen, because the history of Allen is what brought us here today to this specific event. First of all, back in the 1830s and 1840s, there really wasn't much in Collin County because people were just coming into the state to settle it. Of course, the at that point in time, it wasn't a state, it was the Republic of Texas. But in about 1840 to 1850s, that's when people actually started to settle here in earnest. And then in the early 1870s, I've got 1871, I've got 1872, and I've got 1874 as dates that are claimed as being the dates when the railroad came through Collin County. So that's the reason why I say early 1870s, because plus or minus, that's when it happened. One story is that it says the train came through in 1871, but the dam was built in 1874, which didn't seem right to me, because don't you need the water so the train can run? So anyway, that's the reason why I say there's a little bit of question mark about the history of Allen as far as the exact year when the train came through. Steam locomotives needed water to run, and so they had to have water stations about once every 10 miles. And thus, if you go down the old railroad, you'll see that there's a town about every 7 to 10 miles, and the railroad would name those towns as they would go by. And in this case, Allen became Allen Station. And that was because it was named after one of the key individuals in the Houston and Central Texas Railroad, which came through here, and one of the founders of that railroad was an individual named Ebenezer Allen. Thus, you see the name on the train, the Ebenezer Allen. Ebenezer Allen was actually born up in the Northeast, came down to Texas, like a lot of people have done over the last many, many years as Texas has grown. But in the early 1800s, he came in the 1830s. He was a statesman. He was very much involved in the railroad system, and he was also the Republic of Texas Attorney General, and he was also the last Secretary of State for the Republic of Texas. He also became the Attorney General after the state was annexed by the United States. He was actually the crafter of all the documentation that allowed the state to be annexed by the United States. So that's just a little bit of history about our namesake, Ebenezer Allen. So we had the stone dam built, and the train came through, and the train generated commerce. It made a way to where people could travel from one place to another faster. It allowed a way for people and goods and merchandise to be moved around, so it became the a hub for commerce at each little town that the trains came through. Later on, in the early 1900s, Texas Traction Company came in and actually bought a lot of the land that parallels the railroad tracks, and they basically put in a new set of tracks, which became part of what we call the interurban line, or an electric railway. That railway operated from 1907 to 1948. Actually, they had a couple of accidents in the 1940s that became very unfortunate, and because of that, they had to close down then. So we actually had two sets of trains. The interurban was actually very beneficial to the community in the sense that it allowed people to go back and forth from McKinney, Allen, Plano to downtown Dallas, because obviously Dallas was the center or the hub of commerce in Collin and Dallas counties. Once the interurban went out of business in 1948, though, that had a negative impact on the city of Allen, because I think in the 1940s, the population had actually grown to over 1,000 people. But after the interurban went out of business, the town shrunk to actually under 400 people until the early 1960s, when we started getting more roads and cars, and people were able to find different ways to get down to the Dallas area. So with that, I would like to say a little bit about the Allen Heritage Guild. The Allen Heritage Guild is an all-volunteer organization that's dedicated to preserving Allen's history. When did the Allen Heritage Guild get formed? Well, back in 1996, the Chamber of Commerce, just like what they do today, had a leadership Allen, they had leadership Allen classes. Class number 7 in 1996, their class project was to form the Allen Heritage Guild. And so that's how that got started. But in 1999, Class 10 decided that they wanted to do something related to preserving the history of Allen, and they came up with the idea of the building that's next to us today, the depot. So that was their class project. The interesting thing, though, is it's a great idea, but obviously it takes land, which we didn't have this land at that point in time, and it also took money, and they thought maybe for $100,000, $150,000, we could make the project work. Well, it took a couple years for that project to actually become a reality because we had to get the land and we had to get the money. And we also found out that building the depot was going to be a little bit more than $150,000. Ended up being about, I don't know, about $1.5 million to $2 million when it was all said and done. So that's just the way it happened to be. So that's the Allen Heritage Guild, and I'll say a little bit more about them in just a second. So the getting the land and setting aside money to make all of this happen took a couple of years. So it wasn't until about 2001 that the city staff started to work in earnest towards a design and plans for the depot. And at that time, they realized that this particular piece of land here where the trains are now, there was actually an old spur line off the main line that was here. So it almost seemed like it was a natural place to put these trains. But when they did the design, they also thought about the concept of, wouldn't it be nice to have a train? Because if you go down to Plano, Plano's got a historical place down there in the center of the old downtown where they've got an old interurban car. And we thought, wouldn't it be great if we had a steam engine in Allen to help celebrate our history and the history of the railroads in our community? One little tidbit of information I did leave out that I did want to remind everybody about. In February each year, we celebrate kind of this Sam Bass Day thing. And Sam Bass, as you realize, was a train robber by profession. That's what he did. He actually committed the first train robbery in the state of Texas on February 22nd, 1878. Actually, prior to that, he had a big robbery that occurred up in like the Nebraska area, and he got about $60,000 worth of gold $20 coins, and he was kind of like Robin Hood because he had all this money, didn't know what to do with it, and he'd go around and actually hand out $20 gold coins to people if they needed help. And people liked him a lot, and because of that, it was very difficult to catch him because people would cover for him. When the depot project kind of got going, all the attention was focused on getting this built, programming it, and trying to get it off the ground. Because of that, the interest and the desire for the locomotive kind of waned for about 10 years. after about 10 years, there are several people from the guild that came forward and said, you know, we've been talking about this train for a while. Nothing's really happened. What can we do to get this thing going again? So I'm going to mention four people's names in regards to the four key individuals in the guild. Many people were involved, but these were the four that did most of the heavy lifting that actually helped carry this on to get it to where it is today. The individuals are, and I'll have them raise their hands. Hopefully they're here. The first one I'll mention is Ken Byler off to my left. Ken? We also had Jim Rushing. Is Jim here? There he is. Good to see you, Jim. We had Ed Bryan. And Stan Schwartz. I don't know if I saw Stan or not. So those were the members of the guild. Like I said, there were others, but those were the four that did most of the work that I'm aware of. In regards to additional help, the Allen Parks Recreation Department also spent a lot of time working on the project, but there's one individual above all in the Parks and Recreation Department that has done more work with respect to working with Allen Heritage Guild, working on the Allen Heritage Village, working on the depot, and then also working on the locomotive, and that is Brian Bristow in the back. So this group of guild members back in 2011, were searching out, what would be suitable locomotives to be here in Allen. Well, they found that there were still three steam locomotives that actually ran up and down this track that would be ideal candidates because that would best represent the history of Allen and North Texas. Unfortunately, two of those were already committed, which we could never get because they were in places that people wanted them and they didn't want to get rid of them. And I think there was a third one. And the people that are on the committee, if I don't have all my facts correct, act like they are, okay? But the third one was an older locomotive that was located out in Georgia. Unfortunately, it was sitting out in the field and it was kind of rusty. And I think the guy that we're trying to purchase it from knew that it was the last available historical locomotive, and he knew we wanted it really bad, and he wanted a really high price. And unfortunately, because of that, the fact that it was in very poor condition, it was going to take a lot of money to purchase, to transport, to basically restore it to where we could actually put it on the tracks behind us. So because of that, and the fact that, well, let me just add this bit of information. One, the Community Development Corporation actually provided $150,000 at that point in time to help with getting this locomotive. Because of the cost of the train in Georgia, the restoration cost and other things, it was gonna, the budget to do that was gonna well exceed $150,000. And because of that, the project kind of waned again for another several years until about 2018, 2019. The discussion came back in earnest again about what are we gonna do to get this train? We really need to do something to get it going again. So what happened is in 2019, the Guild had a new president, Maureen Honeycutt, and Maureen was a workhorse and she was dedicated towards trying to help make this a reality. She'd heard everybody talk about it, and so she kind of got online and I guess maybe due to the benefit of technology and the improvements in technology over time, she was able to find the Locomotives Are Us on the website that basically showed where all of these locomotives were all across the country, what was available, what their history was, how much they cost, and we were able to find a locomotive that seemed to meet our needs. So with that, she got with the Parks and Recreation staff and they started doing a little bit more research, and they Brian Bristow again did a lot of legwork to help us out with this. And we found several locomotives, but we're trying to find locomotives that met all the parameters relative to cost and restoration and some other things. So we found a 1910 Lake Superior and Ishpeming, or what they call an LS&I locomotive and tender, which is what's behind us right now. It was located in Alamosa, Colorado. And they found out that before it was put in the place in Alamosa where it was sitting, it was actually operational. So they kind of drove it to the spot, set it, and basically decommissioned it, and that's where it sat until it became available to us. The bad thing is after we looked at it, we made an offer. We found out that the company that owned the train, the name of the company was the Rio Grande Scenic Railroad. Apparently they were in some sort of bankruptcy situation, so it delayed our efforts to try to purchase it. But eventually in February of 2020, we were actually able to secure purchasing of the locomotive and tender, and then we started working on plans as to how to get it here, what it would cost, and also take care of the foundation and all the preparation work to make it able to be put in this location. And again, Brian Bristow did a lot of that work, and we certainly appreciate his efforts for everything that he's done to get us here, because out of all the people that's present here today, he's the guy that probably should get the most credit for having the locomotive in place. So how much did all this cost? Well, we had $150,000 set aside by the CDC. Parks also added a little bit of money to the pot through $70,000 out of their operating funds. And then basically the city council was able to set aside $342,000 of non-bond fund money, which may not mean a whole lot to you, but it's basically taking some of our savings account and putting it towards a train. And it all totaled about $563,000 to do everything that I just talked about up to today. So That really isn't a bad deal if you think about it. If you go out and look at prices on locomotives and look at what it costs to do all this, I think Brian did an outstanding job of getting it in at a very reasonable cost. So Brian did work on all the plans and worked with a consultant to kind of help make all this happen. We were very fortunate because up in Alamosa, Colorado, there's a company called Morton Locomotive and Machine, an individual named Stephen Butler. And I assume Stephen is not here, correct? Okay, all right. Anyway, Stephen Butler worked for the San Luis and Rio Grande Railroad, had hands-on experience actually working on this locomotive. And so his company was the company that bid to basically disassemble, transport, reassemble, and put everything back together again. And he was able to do all that in very short order. And we were very appreciative of the fact that the guy that worked on it was actually the guy putting it all together. The locomotive actually arrived in October 14th of 2020. There's been a little bit of work that's been done to it since it was reassembled, including a new coat of paint. So hopefully you appreciate the fact that it's nice and shiny and looks very good. The other thing I'd like to note, though, is we're talking about the locomotive, we're talking about the tender, but you'll see that it's got a companion over here to my left. So that's a caboose that might look familiar, although it looks a little different because it's been painted and relabeled and everything. But that caboose is the caboose that was over at the village of Allen. If you remember that, it was over there. It was kind of like a kid's playground area. And Noreen Bowen, who worked for the Herring Company, which helped develop the village of Allen, but she also worked for the property management company that took care of the village for a while. And she had indicated whenever that was displaced because of the land being needed to develop more outlets on that site, she said that she would try to help get that caboose for us, thinking that we might want it as a companion to the locomotive. Well, she was correct. I think is it the wine place over there at Village of Allen and a couple other things caused the need for the caboose to be displaced, and they were looking for a home for it, and so we kind of raised our hand and said, if you'll donate it, we'll help get it over here, and we'll go ahead and try to refurbish it the best we can to kind of suit our purposes at this site. So we definitely want to say thank you to Noreen Bowen for that contribution. So with that, that's all the background that I have to offer about the locomotive. But as you can see, it's been a long, winding road to get here. And I'm very proud of the fact that the city has, you know, been able to go ahead and finally take care of getting this locomotive in place. I think it's gorgeous. I think it's a great amenity to our community and definitely is a testament to our history and heritage with respect to the railroad coming through Allen. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn the podium over to Paula Ross, who is a longtime member of the Allen Heritage Guild, and she may have some other things that she wants to say, and she may also want to recognize some other members of the Guild that I did not at this point in time. So Paula, if you could please come forward.
Thank you, Ken, but I think you said everything that I was going to say, only I was going to say it briefer. So anyway, we'll say it this way. I'm going to start out, it's about time. It's wonderful, and the train looks fabulous. It was worth the wait, don't you agree? Yeah. As he said, the Allen Heritage Guild was a project of Leadership Allen Class 7 and was incorporated in 1996. Almost immediately, the Guild talked of a locomotive to be placed in Allen to commemorate the early beginnings of Allen Station. Without the water stop and the railroad, Allen would not exist. Talk escalated when Leadership Allen Class 10 recreated the depot. Members started some searches for locomotive, but didn't get good results. The desire for a locomotive and the interest it would bring to our downtown area never faded. And now, more than 25 years later, the city proudly has purchased a locomotive and tender, and we also have a caboose. This truly acknowledges our railroad history in Allen, and thank you, city, for doing that. I would like to acknowledge Guild members who have dreamed about, who've planned for, who've searched for, lobbied for, and requested a locomotive for Allen, Texas. Ken Byler, your public art is here. Jim Rushing spent hours trying to acquire a similar locomotive. Ed Bryan, Jim Walbauer, Stan Swartz, Tom Keener kept the dream alive in many, many ways. And finally, as Ken said, Maureen Honeycutt, who was president of the Guild a few years ago, wanted a locomotive and searched the internet and railroad sites looking for one and found this one. She notified the city, and Brian Bristow was able to check it out and was instrumental in acquiring it. Thank you all for your vision. You've done the city proud. Thank you so much. Ken wants to say something.
Mr. Byler wants to say a few words.
Come on up, Ken.
I haven't heard a word to say.
Okay.
Ed Bryan and Jim Rushing, Anita Rushing, Brian Bristow, sadly to say, and Paula Ross. We're missing one that started on the train committee. We've been working on a train gang for 15 years now. But if you wait long enough and work hard enough, then all good things will happen. I was lucky enough to be born and raised in Allen, as were my parents, as was my wife, and her parents. So I have a long history with Allen, Texas. The important thing about the Ebenezer Allen here is it was the first of many things. It was the first chartered railroad to take a north-south route, chartered by Ebenezer Allen. It was the first railroad that switched from coal and wood to oil to fire the boilers. It was the first railroad that used arc lights instead of just a kerosene candle out in front. So it was many firsts. I'm so proud of this day. I'm so proud of the people that I worked with. There's another one that needs to be mentioned, and that's Peter Vargas, the former city manager. Peter Vargas was on board as a city manager when we started this train gang 15 years ago. But the way it all began was at the Allen Heritage Guild meeting one night. I said, if anybody would like to see a train on those tracks out here, we'll have a meeting at my house. At that meeting was Jim and Anita Rushing, and Ed and Marge Bryan, and we decided we would get a train on the tracks here at Allen. Anita Rushing, she called Brian Bristow, and we all met at the Allen Cafe the following week. So Brian Bristow, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for the diligence that you showed in making this happen. I want to thank the city manager now for continuing the process that Peter Vargas started. But I don't think I've left anybody out. Oh, I have left Stan Schwartz. He was at the original meeting. Stan was very knowledgeable in trains. When we first started, there was only three trains in existence, three locomotives in existence that had actually been on these tracks through Allen. One was in a field in Georgia. Jim Rushing went down there and tried to buy it. Wasn't for sale, or the price was too high at the time. For some way, it didn't pan out. And the other train that actually traveled on these tracks is over at Grapevine. With the cylinder blown out of it, and it's sitting there today. And the other one is in the Moody Transportation Museum in Galveston, Texas. That's the three trains that existed that went through Allen. We were not able to get any of them, but we tried our damnedest. I know Jim Rushing worked awful hard to try to get the one in Georgia. But anyway, I know I've talked too long. I just want to thank you all for listening for what I've had to say. I want to close my little speech by saying a little prayer, which is, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Son. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for this day.
Thank you, Ken. At this point in time, I think Kate Meacham has some photo opportunities and some other things she wants to tell us about, and we'll continue the celebration. Thank you.
Thank you so much to everybody who came out this evening. We're very excited to finally have the locomotive and the caboose done and painted and ready for the community. So just want to say thank you to all of those who participated and helped get us here today. So thank you all very much for coming.